You came up with a little bit of a different business model, I think, than what people have traditionally known visual effects houses to be. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about how you changed your business structure?
If you're a tentpole $200 million film at a studio, when you're setting it up, you hire your visual effects producer, your visual effects supervisor, you pay them a lot of money, you buy equipment, you set up your own infrastructure, you may have artists, you have a team of 15, 10 people on it, you might have pre-vis artists, and then you have that team subcontract out the work to the vendors around the world that make the most sense to do that work. When the production is over, they shutter the department and they sell the equipment for 50 cents on the dollar. It's great if you're a $200 million production, but if you're a $50 million production, you can still benefit from that same structure, but you can't really afford to put it in place. So what we do is we target those films and we keep the infrastructure in place, and we can offer that kind of that big bang to smaller budgeted productions.
So tell me, how did Creative Cartel come to be?
Creative Cartel came into fruition. As you know, I was at Sony Pictures Imageworks for 11 years as Executive Vice President of Production. We ran a lot of big shows through there, a lot of big tentpole visual effects shows. And as the industry has by my perception, been changing, it was becoming increasingly difficult to try and help steer the company in the direction that it needed to go to stay with the changing times. So at a certain point, I felt like I would be better served by actually going out and being able to be more nimble and offering a service to shows, to the changing needs of productions in the changing world of visual effects, where I could kind of service the shows and the filmmakers in a way that I thought was more suited to the times. What we are is kind of a central repository for all of the images and all of the elements on a film. So everything that's done for the film that's you know, not the smallest minutia, but you know, plates and elements and versions, we store all that locally so that it's all in one central repository. So at the end of the show, it becomes especially important because we can archive all of this and turn over a set of drives to the studio or the production and say, here are all your assets from the show tucked on a nice, neat drive with a nice directory structure for you.
Okay. You had mentioned before, too, that you use CineSync. And how does that work exactly for those that have never seen it? Is it how does one keep from marking the same clip twice or having too many hands in the same spot at the same time?
Mm-hmm. Well, everybody has different color tools. Okay. So you might be blue, I might be red. So if there's a blue mark, I know it's yours. If it's red, it's mine. And basically, and I'm not a highly technical person, believe it or not, but essentially, CineSync works. Everybody needs to have the same files on their computer. And what CineSync does, you have one person who starts the session, and if that's us, we load all of our files into the master session, and then we pass out session keys, and people can log into that, and providing they have the same files on their computer, and they tell the CineSync where it is, then what CineSync does is synchronizes the viewing on all of the machines of those videos. So,
okay.
To be a successful mid-size visual effects company today, you need to have a hook. And that hook can be anything. It can be, we do water really well, or you know, we know how to do talking animals, or we just have great production people who make you feel so comfortable and taken care of, you know everything's gonna be okay. But there has to be a hook. And if you don't have a hook, I think that it's very competitive because you're competing with people who can set up small operations in their own garage. You're competing with companies that are set up in countries where there are, or states where there are tax incentives or lower wages. So it's I think that that's a really tough group to be in, that midsize. I think that for the larger companies, they're looking into ways of being more creative with how they approach the shows, whether it's by deferring some of their soft costs for back end, making it more affordable for the productions, whether it's offering to manage the visual effects work much in the way that I would do it. It's a 500 shot show, we'll keep these 100 shots here because you need our expertise, but these other 400 we can get done cheaper for you, so we'll manage that process. They're having to be more creative, I think, in how they approach big studio shows.
Mm.